Just walking down the street, you can't help but notice. Maybe they make their presence known, or hide out of sight, but they inhabit the world alongside us in a very distinctive way. I'm Christopher Joyce, and I'd like to introduce you to a collection of stories that celebrates the sheer variety and beauty of the animal world. From whale sharks to prairie dogs to sea otters and dolphins, purple martins, wild horses, red pandas, and beer-drinking tree shrews. And though they can't really speak for themselves, it seems clear these animals have a story to tell. Enjoy. The grizzly bear is a creature that reminds us of our place in the food chain. They can tower over 10 feet tall on their hind legs. They have claws that can grow over 4 inches long, and they are fast. And if we should encounter a grizzly bear in the wild, it will likely be an experience we will never forget. Here are 3 stories of such encounters. You'll hear biologist Chris Servine of the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, hunter Joe Tilden, and Chuck Neal, a retired government field scientist.
Something magical about grizzly bears instills that memory in us. And anybody that ever sees a grizzly bear can remember all the details of the time and the place and the weather and who they were with.
It was early in the morning, and I was walking down an old logging road, and it was very gray, and you could just start to see. And I had just seen a moose track. And so up in the logging road, in front of me, probably about 75 yards, I could see this dark thing. And so I looked at it through my binoculars, and there was this grizzly bear standing there looking at me like that.
It was a very hot day, and as I crawled into the den, the immediate sense was that, geez, this smells really strongly like a bear.
Early July this year, working my way through this burn area with down timber, I suddenly heard this deep, hoarse, and the jaw popping, and the bear came up over top of a series of down logs, perhaps 35 yards in front of me. Beautiful, beautiful bear, all blonde grizzly.
It was probably 20 degrees cooler inside that den than it was out on that sunny slope. And the guy that was with me was outside the den, and he said, "Hey, there's a bear. Come out."
And so all of a sudden, the bear just turned around. And he stood there for just a few seconds looking at me, and then he started walking towards me.
She came up on top of the logs and bounded down toward me, huffing and jaw-popping, and ears back, you know. Definitely, she was irritated.
And so she just started to make this low, groaning sound that they sometimes make, just kind of like that.
And I started talking to the bear in a very calm voice, you know, and I was saying, "Look, bear, you really don't want to come any closer than that," and those kind of things, you know, "and why don't you get out of here?"
And I, of course, started talking to her. This is what I've done for 30 years, because it's worked every time for me. Just talk, just me, bear, no harm, bear, no harm, bear, passing through, bear.
I think we said a few things like, hey, bear, you know, that kind of stuff that we usually say to bears. It's, you know, it's always generally thought of that if you speak to a bear in calm, low tones, that it's more of a reassurance and a way to interact with a bear in those close encounter situations to try to minimize surprises on both sides.
Don't get hysterical. Don't yell. Don't run. Whatever you do, don't run. Stand still and talk to the bear and look slightly to one side while watching the bear. Don't stare right in her eyes.
He finally turned and walked over a hill down into the timber. I wasn't afraid because I had a rifle and I knew that I could kill the bear. But that's the first time I'd ever had a bear like that. There was a lone bear, no cubs, that absolutely showed no fear of me whatsoever. So anyway, what I ended up doing, I broke into a clearing and I went out and sat in the clearing for about an hour until it got very daylight and I could see what was going on.
We immediately left the area and went straight up the hill to the helicopter. And I left my measuring tape and various other things inside the den for her, I guess. And that's the first time that we'd ever documented that grizzly bears go into their own dens in the summertime.
It's never over until it's over, to paraphrase Yogi, because I've had them come back again, and that's what she did. She came bounding back down again, up on top of the log pile, back on my side, down toward me again, repeating the whole process. Just as graceful as a big cat. I just looked at her and admired her. And she went back down and picked up her youngsters and started going up the hillside. And she would stop every 20 yards or so and chew me out. And for an hour or two afterwards, there's electricity in the air that wasn't there before. You feel more alive than you felt just 5 minutes before.
I mean, every time you encounter a grizzly bear, it makes your heart rate. It's always a very exciting. And I mean, your heart is always going at these times because it's a large animal that doesn't necessarily like to be close to people.
It's very important that we have an animal out there that is larger and more powerful and who is capable of preying on us on very, very rare occasions. We need that as a species to remain humble when we're out there. Otherwise, we're just totally arrogant. And that's what the people don't want, that feeling of humility. They want to be arrogant. They want to feel like the top dog, and they're terrified at the prospect that there's another animal out there who may be more powerful than they are. And that's just what they need, but that's not what they want.
Chuck Neal, Joe Tilden, and Chris Servi. And now for a story I did about those elusive nocturnal creatures who have quite a hold on our imagination. I went with my audio engineer buddy Bill McQuay to an abandoned copper mine in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan to get the sound of bats in their hibernaculum.
It was part of Morning Edition's radio expedition series about the natural world, and what we found out was bats had taken up residence in a very deep abandoned copper mine.
So we joined some scientists who were going down into these mines, rappelling down on ropes. What they were doing was finding which mines the bats were in and covering over the entrances with these big metal grates.
Those grates would keep people out, but the bats could come and go as they pleased.
Steve Smith, a local guy, roped us up, and Bill went down first, about 30 feet below on a ledge, and then I followed, and I thought this was going to be easy.
First thing you do is check your carabiner, make sure it's shut. Make sure your harness is doubled back. That way you won't fall out of it.
On rope!
Okay, coming down. Halfway down, I make a beginner's mistake. There are big, loose rocks clinging to the wall. I step on one.
Rock! Holy run!
Watch out.
You all right? It only takes one rock to really ruin your day.
I'm so sorry about that, Bill.
Yeah, and after all that, we didn't even find any bats in that mine.
The next day, though, we got lucky. It was another mine shaft, and it was pitch black, lots of water dripping from the ceilings, and we found this huge cavern. And there on the ceiling, hanging in these big clumps, were thousands of bats.
Here's where you need to lean in and listen. We remixed these pieces in 3D sound, so if you can, listen with stereo headphones. It'll make you feel you're really there.
And now here's NPR science correspondent Joe Palca with an ant traffic report.
Good morning, everyone. Looks like another no-hassle day on the ant highways. Traffic is moving smoothly on Jungle Route 17 near the split. Ants are traveling at speed coming in on 95 through the savannah. Heavy volume, but no slowdowns on Parkside Drive near the picnic basket. Now, you may have noticed something a little surprising about this traffic report. No traffic jams. Physicist Apoorva Nagar at the Indian Institute of Space Science and Technology says it turns out, for the most part, ants don't have traffic jams. Nagar wanted to know why that was and whether human traffic engineers could learn a thing or two from ants about how to avoid jams. I reached Nagar via Skype in his office in Kerala, India. He says there are basically three reasons ants don't jam up when running together in a single direction. Number one, ants don't have egos. They don't show off by zooming past slowpokes.
They do not want to overtake each other.
No aggressive drivers on an ant highway.
The second thing is that they do not mind a few accidents or collisions.
So unless there's a serious pileup, they just keep going. And the third reason?
Ants seem to get more disciplined as the density increases.
More discipline means no rubbernecking or distracted driving. Nagar felt this kind of behavior could be explained by something called the Langevin equation. an equation physicists use when describing the movement of liquids or how individual atoms behave in a lattice. I wasn't entirely familiar with the Langevin equation, so I turned to Thomas Donnelly, a physics professor at Harvey Mudd College.
This is basically a reworking of Newton's famous F equals ma equation.
Oh, yes, of course. Force equals mass times acceleration.
So it's all Newton, but they're using a sort of special description of the forces, which includes a random component.
Okay, I think that's as far as I'm going to go in explaining that. But the bottom line is when Nagar made a mathematical model of the ants' traffic patterns using the Langevin equation and compared what his model predicted with what experiments with ants running in a line showed.
And it sort of seemed to fit very well with the experiment.
So he wrote up his results, and they will appear in an upcoming issue of the journal Physical Review E. Nagar is not sure how relevant his model will be for human traffic engineers. After all, he agrees allowing cars to bump into each other at 60 miles an hour may be a non-starter. Although greater discipline and less ego should help keep traffic flowing smoothly. There's one other tiny problem. Nagar is a physicist, not an ant man. I've talked with ant researchers who say when the volume of ants is high enough, ants do jam up. But I suppose you could solve that problem by building more ant highways. Joe Palca, NPR News.
So I left my job about 5 o'clock, 15 minutes to go 3 blocks, just in time to stand in line, the freeway looking like a parking lot. Damn, this traffic jam,
how I hate to be alone. In the 1960s, textbooks still described humans as the only creatures to make and use tools. That changed in the 1970s when Jane Goodall observed chimpanzees doing just that. We've now discovered a full range of animal tool use, from wasps that tamp down soil with a pebble to elephants that throw stones at their enemies. The book, Animal Tool Behavior, released in 2011, reveals that a lot of old ideas about animals and tools are simply wrong. NPR's John Hamilton visited the Indianapolis Zoo to speak with one of the authors.
I'm touring the exhibits with Rob Shoemaker. He's vice president for life sciences here and also teaches at Indiana University.
Well, we're approaching our polar bear exhibit, and we have this adult female tundra, and she is about as beautiful as a polar bear can be.
Shoemaker says one goal of the book, which he wrote with Benjamin Beck and Christina Walkup, is to correct some widespread misconceptions, like the idea that tool use is limited to monkeys and apes.
We have these great stories about polar bear tool use that are in the historical literature. And one of the stories we have is polar bears getting up on a cliff and hurling great chunks of ice down on something like a walrus to kill it.
While that's an anecdote, there's no doubt that polar bears in zoos often throw objects with great force and accuracy. Shoemaker says another common misconception is that tool use requires fingers, or at least hands. He says no one bothered to tell dolphins they couldn't use tools.
They're really, really remarkable. And to me, what's so interesting about dolphins is they have nothing to hold tools with except their mouth. And yet, they're still innovative and creative.
Shoemaker says dolphins play with just about any object they find. But in this context, the objects are just toys. Something becomes a tool when it's used to manipulate another object or creature for a specific purpose. Jody Baker is in charge of marine mammals. She says a dolphin named Chemo often manipulates.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.